So, today I'll explain why art is never going to die, both personally and professionally, and I'll give you some advice on how you can actually thrive in this new environment of emerging technology. Now, a lot of people who perpetuate the art apocalypse scenario use the argument of, why would anyone pay for something when they can press a button to do it themselves? And at first, this sounds fine, but it actually makes no sense as soon as you try to apply it in real life. And we talked a little bit about this in my previous video called Being Honest with Your Goals. And the gist of it is, learning how to do everything is often detrimental. Just because you can learn how to do everything doesn't mean you should. And most of the time, trying to split your attention between multiple different things will often lead you to accomplishing none of them. And usually it will hurt the quality of your end product, and your users are just gonna feel like, eh, it was okay. And I've seen this happen over and over again. Let's use me for example. In my case, I'm a game developer. My roots are in 3D modeling and animation. So modeling, texturing, rigging, animating, and anything regarding 3D characters is all stuff I know how to do and am very familiar with. But when I am leading a project for a game, my number one priority is to make something the players enjoy. And if I've got a small team working for me, I have to manage other shit. I would prefer to spend most of my time 3D animation, but that almost never happens because often I'll have to help out with designing the environment, storyboarding the cutscenes, sometimes I'm programming or helping with design, or sometimes I'm just physically going to events and conventions to advertise and market the game to potential customers. And that is why I hire people to do stuff for me. You see, I have a texture guy on my team. If you've seen my Jiggle Physics video or the Tactical Knight or the Archer Girl in the recent tutorials, you've seen his work. He's amazing. Now, as a 3D artist, I already know how to texture. I'm pretty good at it. I've textured literally thousands of models before. But the reason I hire a texture guy is not because I don't know how to texture or lack the ability to learn to texture. I hire him because my time is needed doing other things. And because he's a specialist, he can do the same job better and faster than me. Because what would take me 6 or 7 hours to do would take him 30 minutes. And I can put those 7 hours in other stuff that is gonna progress my project much faster and farther. And this is actually the main reason most people hire other people. Why do you think most YouTubers hire a video editor or someone to clip their shorts? It's not because most YouTubers don't know how to edit their own video. It's to save time. I mean, you know, programmers hire each other all the time. I know a programmer who specializes in making combat engines, and for his projects, he'll hire other programmers to handle things like a leaderboard or the UI. And the reason he hires these other programmers is not because he lacks the abilities to learn to do UI or to learn to program a leaderboard. He just knows his time is best spent doing his specialty and letting the other programmers do theirs. And this is the key that art-oriented people kind of have a hard time understanding. You see, it's really hard for artists to imagine someone not wanting to make art. Most artists assume that if art was easy and people had the option, everyone would choose to make art all the time. And this is just not how people work. At the end of the day, most people do things because they want to. Think about it. Right now, everyone on the planet has access to ChatGPT. You give it a prompt and it can write whatever you need, however long you need it to be, in seconds. Of course, it's not perfect and it requires some proofreading and checking, but it literally has never been easier. Anyone with a keyboard and the internet could learn to be a professional writer right now. But why doesn't everyone around you looking to start their career in journalism? Why isn't everyone writing novels? Why isn't everyone drafting scripts or articles? Everyone's got the tools, the skill barrier is basically gone. Why isn't everyone becoming a writer? Well, the clear answer is not everyone wants to be a writer. And in fact, most people don't want to be a writer. It's the same way not everyone wants to be a news reporter. Or not everyone wants to be a dancer. Like, for me personally, I don't care how easy you make dancing. If I could download a dance into my brain and body and then press a button to execute it perfectly without practice, I still wouldn't spend my spare time dancing. I don't care how easy it becomes. It's just not something I'm interested in. And believe it or not, the average person doesn't want to be an artist. I promise if you walk into your local Walmart right now, most of the people in that store are not planning to spend their spare time when they get home generating AI art, no matter how easy the software gets. The amount of people who actually do art as a means to make a living is less than 2% of the entire population. Now, let's say you want to be in that 2% of people who do art professionally. Let's talk about why I'm sure there will still be work available for future artists commercially. So let's look at art history. Every time an advancement in technology has made art easier, it's always met with two phases. The initial pushback from old school artists claiming that the new technique is soulless and inhuman and no skill and it's killing art. And the second phase where it's inevitably accepted and embraced as the standard by the next generation. Now, a lot of my family are artists and they studied art history in school. And I'll share some interesting things that I've heard from them about historical art that I think the rest of the world is just kind of forgetting. Back in the day, you know, like hundreds of years ago, before paint colors were standardized, you couldn't just go to your local shop and buy paint. If you didn't know the secret technique to get that perfect shade of color you needed, guess what? You had no paint. Mixing paint was a special valuable skill that separated amateur artists from the professionals. And as paint was becoming a standard item that was available to more and more people, the professional artists would say, "Oh my god, look at these scrubs. You know, you're not a real artist unless you mix your own paint." Literally, that was a held opinion within the art community of the time. But of course, that's stupid, and paint became standardized, and now we all know that just because you don't make your own colors doesn't mean you're not an artist. If we look at the art of writing, you know, back in the day, before we had typewriters and printers, if you wanted to copy a book, you literally had to copy it word for word by hand. This used to be a profession. And it was extremely difficult and time-consuming. And of course, when technology advanced to the point where we could actually just have a machine mass-produce copies of a book, all the professional people whose job it was to manually write and copy that book said, "Oh, it's not human, it's soulless, there's no connection between the human heart and the words on the page anymore. This is going to kill literature, and we'll end up with a black hole of mushy amateur nonsense writing everywhere. It will be the end of stories as we know it." And of course, later on, we get amazing stories like Lord of the Rings, Harry Potter, beautiful movie scripts like Star Wars, Terminator, the list goes on. What about email, when that started to become standard? Mail offices were like, "No, don't do that, it's gonna kill all the mail jobs and we're gonna starve to death." Look how that panned out. They're still there, and they're still very active. Or if we look at another art like music, does anyone remember when electronic music was still underground and just starting out? And how we went through a musical phase where traditional musicians who played in band and orchestra shunned DJs, telling them that, yeah, it's not real music because there's no real instruments being played. Computer music is too easy and no skill. Look where we are now. Nobody would deny that electronic music and instruments are no less a musical art than traditional music. When photography was invented, everyone was like, "Well, it looks like art's dead. Why would you ever paint a portrait of yourself when you could take a selfie? Or why would you ever paint a landscape when you could just take a picture of it?" Again and again and again, the answer is because people want to. This cycle happens all the time. Art never dies, it only evolves. There are still people today making a living off playing real instruments. There are still people today making a living off of creating hand-drawn art, and there will continue to be those people in the future. Advancements in technology are never going to stop. And I believe that's a good thing, because nobody wants to go back to the point where if you wanted to send a message to 100 people, you had to physically write 100 letters, then deliver them to each person by hand. Nobody wants to go back to a point where if you needed paint for a canvas, you had to go find the right flour and mix it with cow piss to get the specific yellow-green color your masterpiece needed. At the end of each cycle, way more opportunities are created than lost. Think about how many painting jobs might have been available back then with no technology. Now compare that to the amount of computer art jobs that are available today. It's not even comparable how many more jobs and opportunities are available for artists now than back in the 1500s. And, in fact, you could probably argue that a new market has been created because there are now entire art communities that crave pure human art. So if you really don't want to use AI and you still want to do your art, now you have a new audience that is specifically looking for you. Pure human art is going to become more valuable and in demand because it's going to be a lot more rare. and standard art is just going to evolve into a hybrid form. Teams will likely become much smaller, but the number of small studios is going to rise, and smaller teams are now going to be able to generate content that used to only be available to AAA companies. We're already seeing how smaller indie teams can compete with AAA titles in the gaming industry, and it's awesome to watch. And if you're a commercial artist wondering how you could adapt to the new environment, you are actually in the best possible position to capitalize on this opportunity. Just think about it from the perspective of a small business owner. I'll just use myself for example. I don't like making environments. I can. I'm a 3D artist. I know how to do it. And even though AI could make it really easy for me, I would still rather spend my time designing characters. So in the future, I'm planning to hire an environment guy to help me make environments in Unreal 5. But let's say I had the position open available now, and there were two candidates that I could choose from. Both are experts in generating styles of images I want and 3D models with AI. But one of them knows how to do it manually. Who do you think I'm going to hire? Obviously, I'm going to hire the person who can do both. You, as a traditional artist, have years of experience understanding perspective, lighting, coloring, proportions, scene design. You have a bunch of things that are important to know how to do as an artist that someone purely using AI probably isn't going to be familiar with. Right now, you can get ahead of the game and put yourself in the best position possible to stick out against other candidates who are going to grow up in a generation of AI. So the choice is yours. I recommend maximizing your opportunity for future prospects by keeping both your art skills up and your understanding of how to combine it with the use of AI. But again, even if you don't want to learn AI, that's fine too, because there are new markets emerging which will allow you to start catering and advertising to the types of customers that are only looking for pure human art. That is where you're going to build your clientele. So I hope that explains why you as an artist shouldn't be afraid of the future. There's always going to be a market for it, especially now more than ever. And there's definitely things that you can do right now to take advantage of the situation to make sure you come out on top. Hope that helps. And as always, hope you have a fantastic day, and I'll see you around.